إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد اللهم صل وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Today's class, inshallah, will be short, so we will take it until Isha, and then that's it. So there won't be a continuation after Isha today, inshallah. today we will establish we'll pave the way for our subsequent meetings as to how to deal with what we can consider to be the third phase of in the story of fiqh, the third phase. After the Prophet ﷺ. So if you count the time of the Prophet ﷺ, it would be the fourth. If you discount the era of the Prophet ﷺ, it would be the third. So we have the lifetime of the Messenger ﷺ, fiqh, during that time. And then we had fiqh in the time of the Al-Khulafa Al-Rashidun, the four rightly guided caliphs. And lately, or last thing we studied was the time after 40 Hijri until, as we said, around 120, 130 after Hijrah. So these are three phases. The fourth is what we will start with today. And as I said, if you want to discount the time of the Prophet ﷺ because it was direct revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so fiqh and sharia were pretty much the same for the most part. But you can call this to be, consider this to be the third phase. This third phase, there was some kind of influence based on the political situation. Things happened because the Al-Khilaf al-Umawiyya, or the Umayyad Caliphate, was deteriorating and was losing power. In secret, there was another government in the making, or another caliphate in the making. And that was basically Al-Khilaf Al-Abbasiyya, the Abbaside Caliphate. And the proponents of this Khilafah were more in line with the right, or what they claimed to be the right of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu, and the Ahl al-Bayt, the household of the Messenger sallam, to be the Khulafa. So they sided with the descendants of Al-Abbas and the family of Al-Bayt in order to establish the Khilafah Al-Abbasiyya. Khilafah Al-Abbasiyya, it took over the Umayyad Caliphate, but it was a very vicious and difficult kind of overtaking. And there was a lot of blood that was shed. Even like Al-Khalifa Al-Safah, the first Abbasi Khalifa, he killed a huge number from Banu Umayyah. To the extent some of the books of fiqh mention that he actually got thousands of skulls of the people of Umayyah. Thousands of skulls. And he asked for them to be collected. And he made a bed for himself from these skulls. Unfortunately. So that was the case. So Al-Khilaf Al-Abbasiyya took over, the Umayyads, most of them were killed, especially the people who were connected to the government. Some of them managed to fled to the North Africa, to the far west of North Africa, to what's known today as Morocco, and they managed to get to settle in Al-Andalus, which is in Spain. And then they established there a new Khilafah Umayyah, So the Abbasides, they established their power. But yet, even in North Africa, there was another group that was actually seeking power. And these were Al-Adarisa. So they came actually, they fought at the beginning. There was a person called Idris. And he was actually fighting against the Abbasides for power. So he managed to to run away from them, and he made it to North Africa, and they're among the indigenous population in North Africa, Al-Amazigh. He managed to get a lot of support from them and some of the Arabs who settled there, and they established what could be called as a Dawla al-Idrisiya. Some historians consider it to be Khilafah, but it wasn't big enough to be a Khilafah. Most of those, the remains of those, most of them were in what's known today as Algeria and Tunisia. A lot of their legacy was in Tunisia, in Al-Qayrawan. So, anyway, that's the political, and also some, there was a lot of conflict in the Abbasid Khilafah. So some of them gave, some of the caliphs, you know, gave more power and more footing for Arabs among the government, body of the government. Some other caliphs gave more preference to the Persians, So there was a conflict between the Arabs and Persians over power, then until Al-Mu'tasim came, Al-Mu'tasim Billah, he favored the Turks. He favored the Turks, because his mother was Turkish. So he brought a lot of Turks into the government until they actually managed to get very strong hold over the caliphate. So the caliphs afterwards were more like some, a little bit more like, to a certain extent, even actually, especially towards the end of the Abbasid caliphate, they were more like puppets, just a head figure. That's it. During this time, what happened, fiqh, let's move now to fiqh and hadith. Now the need for hadith to be documented started to take root among the Arabs. And you remember we said last time, it was Umar bin Abdul Aziz who realized the importance of what we call tadween al-hadith. Because the hadith was handed down, was usually taught verbally. There were some people who kept records, but that was a personal effort. So there was no collective effort and official effort to really write down the hadith in collections. The one who really like paid attention to this was Umar bin Abdul Aziz, so he called upon the al-wula, or the governors of different cities, main cities, in order to call upon the scholars to start writing down the hadith and formally, creating collections or bringing together collections of hadith. And he sent to Abu Bakr ibn Hazm, who was his wali or his governor on Mecca. And he sent to Al-Kufa, he sent to Al-Basra, he sent to Medina, so that the scholars start actually writing collections of hadith. Collections started to appear. So like Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Sufyan al-Thawri, they had their own collections, started to become more popular. There were a lot of attempts to write something called Al-Muwatta. Al-Muwatta means something that is made easy. In the Arabic language, tawti'a, that means facilitation, introduction. Something like this. So the one that really became most famous was Muwatta al-Imam Malik. Was the Muwatta of al-Imam Malik. Now we're talking at this time actually spread from, let's say, the year 130 after Hijrah till the year 270 almost. Around that time. Which is the life of the Khilaf al-Abbasiyya, the Abbasid Caliphate. So we're talking generally about this era, what happened. So the collections of hadith started to appear. The one that really stood out at the early stage of this time, of this era, was Muwatta al-Imam Malik. This is why Shafi'i says, لَيْسَ تَحْتَ أَدِيمِ السَّمَاءِ أَصَحَّ بَعْدَ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ مِنْ مُوَطَّى الْإِمَام مَالِكِ. He says, there's nothing under the skies, a notebook that is more authentic, that is second to the Book of Allah, except Muwatta al-Imam Malik. He said that before al-Bukhari and Muslim. So that was the case at the beginning. Muwatta al-Imam Malik, and this is how most of the books at his time, most of the Muwatta'at at his time, were collections of hadith and statements from the companions, athar, and fatawa from the tabi'een. collections of these. There were collections of ahadith, fatawa of the companions, statements from the companions, and fatawa from at-tabi'een. So this is how Muwatta Imam Malik, you'll find a lot of this there. Then the scholars turned towards another type of hadith collections, and this was al-masanid. Al-masanid. Al-masanid basically were, the way they were organized was based on the narrator, the companion who narrates the hadith. The companion who narrates the hadith. So for example, you will find the most famous example is Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. And it's probably the best example on the books of Masanid. In Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, you'll find Musnad Abi Huraira. Okay, the collections of Abu Huraira. So in one place, you'll find all the hadith reported by Abu Huraira, all in one place. Then Musnad Abdullah ibn Umar. Then you will find Musnad, the hadith, all of the hadith narrated by, from Abdullah ibn Umar, through Abdullah ibn Umar. And so on and so forth. So each one of the companions would have a Musnad. Musnad al-Imam Ahmad was such a huge and profound effort because it is a huge collection. Huge collection. Imam Ahmad said more than 100,000 hadith. He himself said that. More than 100,000 hadith. And he chose his Musnad from this huge collection that he had. And in the Musnad, without any repetitions, just the unique hadith, he has around 28,000 and something. 28,000 hadith and something. That's Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. And it was only the hadith. Hardly you find anything from the companions or anything from the tabi'een. So it was specifically for hadith. So the Masanid were mainly pure collections of hadith. That's different from the Muwatta. So that was more, more of a step forward in the compilations of hadith. So the Masanid were exclusively for hadith, stripping the hadith away from other fatawa that were usually narrated with them. Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, a great deal of it are authentic hadith, but he also mentioned some weaker hadith. Some of the hadith have some weakness in them. And little bit of them have issues, real issues, like they were considered very weak. Now someone might say, why did they narrate these? We have to understand the demand of the time. The demand of the time was that lying against the Prophet ﷺ appeared at that time. So fabricated hadith. And it was not easy to really discern or find out the difference. Because when a hadith was spreading around, okay, it came with a chain of narration, and the scholar of hadith doesn't know everyone in the chain of narration, doesn't know everyone. So he has to research. So the focus of the scholars at the time was still specifically with documentation. So they used to document everything that came to them. Everything that came to them, they would document it. This is why Imam Ahmad, the 100,000 hadith that he memorized, that he knows, some of them were authentic, some were not. This is why he included in his Musnad only 28,000. Only 28,000 and change. And somebody might say, okay, why does he, for example, mention some weak hadith? Why does he mention some weak hadith? The scholars mentioned some points of benefit here. They said, some weak hadith, a lot of weak hadith, they came through, like the issue with them was one narrator. In the chain of narration, there was one person. And this one person, if you chase his ahadith, you will find they're not all the same. So you'll find some of his ahadith were actually authentic, that he narrated them when he had a very good memory. But towards the end of his life, his memory deteriorated. Or he lost his books. He lost his books. So you will find these statements very common in the science of hadith, specifically ilm al-rijal, when they talk about the narrators of the hadith. For example, they say, كان حافظا كان ثقة حافظا. He was trustworthy, reliable, and he was a very good memorizer. His memory was perfect. إلا أنه اختلط. Except that towards the end of his life, he lost his mind. But he still narrated some hadith. So the scholars would not take from the time after he lost his mind. But how could they tell? So they had to collect all his hadith and see when the inconsistency started. And okay, this hadith shows signs of inconsistency because it's unlike his first narration and so on and so forth. So there was a lot of scrutiny that the scholars made. Another thing was, for example, there was a scholar that, or there was a narrator of hadith, that Sufyan al-Thawri used to narrate his hadith. But he said to the people, do not take the hadith of this person, except from me. So he said, if you get a hadith and in the chain of narration there is this person, I can't remember the name of the person, don't, you know, discard this hadith, forget it. Don't take it. So they said to him, but like you narrate his hadith, even in your classes, you narrate the hadith from him. He says, إِنِّي أَعْرِفُ صُدْقَهُ مِنْ كَذِبِهِ. I know when he's telling a correct hadith and when he's making it up. I know him. So this is why the scholars, somebody might say, why didn't they just collect the authentic hadith and forgot all about the weaker ones? No, the weaker ones had traces about the narrators of hadith and their style of narration and the weakness and the strength and the different stages they went through. And you will hear, for example, sometimes when they talk about the life of one narrator, they would say, احترقت كتبه فساء حفظه. And at one stage, his books were burnt, like probably his house burnt and his library was lost. So afterwards, he tries to recollect the hadith from his memory, but he didn't have a very strong memory without it being documented. So they would be very careful. So they would recognize by tracing all his narrations the hadith that he narrated when he had his books, and then they would trace back the other ones and be able to tell the difference with the ones that he narrated after he lost his books, and so on and so forth. So the weak hadith, fabricated hadith, they had a lot of clues. There was a lot of knowledge hidden there. So this is why the scholars did not dump these hadith altogether, because they gave them so much knowledge about the narrators. When you search for consistencies, you search for patterns, you can develop very good rules. Why are we talking about hadith? Because one of the main sources of fiqh is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So we need to see what happened to the hadith and the availability of the hadith in order to see how fiqh developed. Afterwards, as the Masanid appeared, specifically Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, and there was in Andalus, there is a huge collection of hadith that's even bigger than Imam Ahmad's book. It was another Musnad called Musnad Baqi ibn Mikhlad. Musnad Baqi ibn Mikhlad. He was in Andalus, in Spain. Musnad Baqi ibn Mikhlad is lost. We don't have it. There is small, you know, parchments from it that were found here and there, but it was lost. And it was far bigger than Musnad Imam Ahmad. Some scholars say it's more than 50,000 hadith in that book. But not all of them are authentic, okay? Not all of them are authentic. Some of the researchers at our time, they actually think it is somewhere in Germany. Yes. Like some of the very active scholars today who search and have very special interest in manuscripts. And it's one of my teachers, Sheikh Mashur. He's been chasing the Musnad of Baqi, the Musnad Baqi ibn Mikhlad, the manuscript for that, for more than 30 years. And he says, I have very strong clues that it's in the house of one German guy. And this German guy is refusing to show the collection he had, which he inherited from his father. And his father inherited it from his grandfather, who was an Orientalist. So he has it in his basement. He has a huge collection of Arabic manuscripts, Arabic books, that no one knows anything about. So the Sheikh has been chasing the history of these manuscripts, and he says, I have very strong clues that it might be in that person's house, but he's refusing to do this. He's refusing to sell it. He's refusing even to let anyone get into it, even German institutions. So that's Musnad Baqi ibn Mikhlad. As these Masanid have documented the hadith that are in circulation, the scholars now decided to look for something, take the whole game of hadith, you know, to the next level. So Imam al-Bukhari was one of excellent students of hadith. And one day he was listening to his sheikh, Abu Zur'a al-Razi. Abu Zur'a al-Razi was saying, I wish that someone would make a compilation of hadith only for the authentic hadith. Only the authentic hadith. So he said, and that resonated with me. So he dedicated the rest of his life to write his Sahih, which became Sahih al-Bukhari, and became the book, the first book of hadith ever, until today. The first book of hadith. Sahih al-Bukhari became the number one among the books of hadith in terms of authenticity. All the main hadith there are authentic. Even the other hadith that he mentioned in support, these are not, they're not supposed to be part of his sahih, but still these ones also are authentic. Also these ones, they call them al-mu'allaqat wal-mutaba'at. Okay, these are not the main hadiths, but he mentioned them in support of some hadith, primary hadith he mentioned. Imam al-Bukhari did something in his sahih that was fascinating. He was a faqih as well. He would not mention the whole hadith. So he did not make like the Masanid, that's Musnad Abu Hurairah, Abi Hurairah, Musnad Abdullah bin Mas'ud. No. He took the subject or the content of the hadith and created headings based on fiqh. So the headings are based on his understanding. Fiqh, there's issues of aqidah, there's issues of salah, issues of siyam, issues of so many things. So he put headings, and under the heading, he put the segment of the hadith that fits that heading. So you will have a hadith, let's say, around a page, that makes a page, full page. So you will find under, for example, Kitab Al-Adab, he will put two lines of it that are relevant, and he will not put the full hadith. But you will find the other segments of the hadith fitting in some other, under other headings. That's Al-Bukhari. This is why recently, in our time, there has been some scholars trying to make Mukhtasar al-Bukhari. Mukhtasar Sahih al-Bukhari. Like they would remove any repetitions, because al-Bukhari also would repeat a hadith in more than one place because it fits more than one heading. So they stripped down the Sahih al-Bukhari from any repetition, and they got the fragmented parts of the hadith, put it into one place. And the best one who did this was Sheikh Al-Albani in his Mukhtasar Sahih Al-Bukhari. He did a wonderful job connecting, because that's lots of work. Because you have to see what is the chain of narration of this hadith, and because Al-Bukhari had for the same hadith more than one chain of narration. That's a bit probably complicated, but it's worth mentioning. So he would have one hadith, which is long, through five chains of narration, Al-Bukhari. So in one spot, he would use part of the hadith, where it fits. Then he would use another part of the hadith in another place, under another heading, another subject. But when he mentions the other segment, he would not mention the same chain of narration, he would mention another chain of narration for variety. So he's very skillful. The Bukhari, like, it's hard to trace him back as how he deals with the Sahih. So Sheikh Al-Bani put so much work. He put years. Sheikh Al-Bani says, like, this book, like has taken a lot from me. It's taken a lot from me. Okay, so that was what Al-Bukhari did, and his book was received favorably by the scholars and became the authority on the authentic or Hadith al-Sahih. Then came Al-Imam Muslim. Imam Muslim was a student. He was more of a colleague and a student of Al-Bukhari. Al-Bukhari was far, far more skillful, far more knowledgeable than Muslim. But Muslim did something slightly similar to Al-Bukhari, which is basically getting only the authentic hadith, and he would put the whole hadith under the heading. So he would not fragment the hadith. Al-Dhahabi said, لولا البخاري لما راح مسلم ولا جاء. He said, had it not been for the Bukhari, Muslim would have not done anything. Basically, it was al-Bukhari that was the main inspiration and source of teaching for Imam Muslim. But his book is absolutely amazing, absolutely amazing. So it comes next after Imam, after the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari. Then came Imam al-Nasa'i. And he wrote his book As-Sunan al-Nasa'i. An-Nasa'i is probably the, in the six books of hadith that are famous, An-Nasa'i is the only Arab, probably. He was born in Palestine. The other ones are mainly from Asia, Asia Minor. So Imam al-Nasa'i wrote his big book. The vast majority of the hadith are authentic, but still Imam al-Nasa'i was a very powerful faqih. So he mixed, he put a lot of fatawa in his book. He put a lot of his fatawa in his book, Sunan al-Nasa'i, Sunan al-Nasa'i. Then came Abu Dawood al-Sajastani. By the way, Sajastani, okay, the Arabs pronounced it in two, that's a place in Iran. So they pronounce it in two ways, Sajastani or Sistani. So Sistani comes from the same place, by the way. Abu Dawood al-Sajastani. So the Arabs used to say either Sajistan or Sistan. Sajistani or Sistani. Abu Dawood was very good with al-ilal as well, the science of al-ilal. So he wrote his Sunan as well, Sunan Abi Dawood. Then came Imam al-Tirmidhi from Tirmidh. Imam al-Tirmidhi, he mixed his, in his book you'll find authentic hadith and some weak hadith, and he would actually grade, he would grade the hadith. He would say sahih, he'd say hasanun sahih, and say hadithun hasan, and so on and so forth. And he had his own terminology. It's not completely off the mainstream terminology. It's actually more of an extension of it, more of a variation of it, more of a variation of it. And Imam al-Tirmidhi as well was very good with ilm al-ilal, the hidden problems with the narrations of hadith, was very strong with that. And he was a student of al-Bukhari. He was a student of al-Bukhari, al-Tirmidhi, was one of the main students of al-Bukhari. And he has shown so much knowledge about al-ilal, the hidden issues with al with the ahadith. And came then Ibn Majah. Ibn Majah is the last book of the six books. And the majority of the books are of the hadith are authentic, but yet he has probably in this these six books of hadith, he has the biggest percentage of weak hadith. But as we said, these hadith, he has a lot of fatawa in his book. Ibn Majah was also a faqih. He's al-Qazwini, from Qazwin. So Imam Ibn Majah has a lot of fiqh. And when he mentioned the hadith that are weak, he actually did that on purpose, as he said, because there were some points of benefit when these hadith were mentioned. So that's generally a very quick kind of tour around these books of hadith. We said Muwatta Imam Malik, Al-Bukhari, Sahih Al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, Sunan An-Nasa'i, Sunan Abi Dawood, Sunan Al-Tirmidhi, although they call it sometimes Sahih Al-Tirmidhi, but it's not Sahih. As Al-Iraqi says, وَمَنْ دَعَاهُ بِقَوْلِهِ صَحِيحًا فَقَدْ أَتَى تَسَاهُلًا صَرِيحًا. Anyone who calls it Sahih, then this is a very lenient approach. So it's basically, it's Sunan Al-Tirmidhi. And then we have Ibn Majah, Sunan Ibn Majah. These are the famous, and we mentioned Musnad al-Imam Ahmad and Musnad Baqi ibn Mikhlad. These are probably like the main major books of hadith until today. Until today. So the hadith went through these stages. Now let's see how what stages fiqh went through. We said previously there was Ahl al-Hadith in al-Hijaz, in Medina mainly, and Ahl al-Ra'i in Iraq. Ahl al-Ra'i in Iraq. This kind of trend continued. This kind of trend continued. And it ultimately led in Iraq to the emergence of Abi Hanifa. So Abu Hanifa being the main scholar, being the main scholar in Iraq. Being the main scholar in Iraq, in the area of Iraq. And he was a very intelligent person. And he also was a merchant. He was a merchant. So he used to sell fabric and clothes. Tijarat al-Khaz. Okay, and silk. So he was a businessman. And he actually, at the beginning, he was a businessman. Then he turned to knowledge. When he saw people of knowledge around him in Al-Basra and Kufa, he actually loved knowledge, so he decided to go into knowledge, and he did better than all the other students. So when his Shaykh Hamad traveled, he became the main teacher in the masjid. Then when Hamad passed away, the only one to actually become the teacher in Al-Kufa was Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah ta'ala, Imam Abu Hanifa. And Imam Abu Hanifa was born around 80, the year 80 after Hijrah. There is a dispute, big dispute among the scholars of Ar-Rijal, scholars of history as well, whether did he meet any of the companions or not? Did he meet any of the companions? Some of them mentioned that he actually met Anas ibn Malik. Some narrations, historical narrations, say that he met Imam the companion Anas ibn Malik. But the majority of the scholars of Rijal or Hadith, they actually think that did not happen. So he's not from a tabi'in. Because the tabi'in are the ones who managed to see the companions, who witnessed, lived and mixed with the companions. So it seems Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, most likely he did not meet any of the companions. Although they said there is a dispute there. And Imam Malik in Medina, he emerged afterwards, shortly afterwards. And as I said, the knowledge of the seven fuqaha of Medina and the hadith that were there, they ended up with Imam Malik. So Imam Malik wrote his book Al-Muwatta. He wrote his book Al-Muwatta. And he became the scholar of Medina. He became the scholar of Medina. And he himself, he said, مَا جَلَسْتُ لِلتَّدْرِيسِ حَتَّى شَهِدَ لِي أَرْبَعُونَ مِنْ كِبَارِ التَّابِعِينَ. He said, I did not sit to teach until 40 of the great companions of التابعين gave me permission, gave me ijaza. So Imam Malik was a scholar of hadith and a scholar of fiqh. And his main focus in his madhab is actually the fact, the historical fact, that most of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ remained in Medina and they maintained the heritage of the Prophet ﷺ. Then التابعين took it from them. So for him, what Ahl al-Madina are upon, what the people of Medina are upon, is a main source of tashri' of legislation. So for him to understand a verse, we see how the people of Medina implement it. To understand a hadith, we see how they implement it. Because for him, that was a living legacy from the time of the Prophet ﷺ. It's only two generations. So for him, it's still authentic. And that's why in al-Fiqh al-Maliki, عَمَلُ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَ, what Ahl al-Madina are upon is one of the main sources. It's not like at the same level as Quran and Sunnah, but it's a way to understand. For him, it's a context to understand the Quran and the Sunnah through. Okay? So if there was a verse or there's a hadith suggesting something, but the people of Medina did not implement it, they actually did the opposite, for him he would say, so most likely this hadith is probably mansukh, abrogated. Or if there's a command in it, and the people in Medina, they do not, and it's not random people of Medina, you're talking about scholars, you're talking about tabi'een. If they did not take it as an obligation, he says, then this command or this imperative, do, okay, is not for obligation, it's for recommendation. Okay, these are some of the specifics of al-fiqh al-maliki, the Maliki madhab. Then afterwards appeared Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam al-Shafi'i showed signs of intelligence from a young age, and he went, his mother sent him to Medina to study with Imam Malik. So he went to Imam Malik when he was about 9-10 years old. He went to study, he went from Mecca to Medina. And when he came to Imam Malik, he came to his doorstep, and Imam Malik said, obviously, like he saw him very young for him to join the class. He said, what do you know? He said, I know Muwatta, your book, by heart. He said, go ahead, show me. So he actually recited for him. He started reciting, so, and it was flowing without any kind of hesitation. So it was very good memory. So Imam Malik was impressed and allowed him to join his halaqa and his classes. So Imam Shafi'i took the knowledge of Imam Malik. He took the knowledge of Imam Malik. And then obviously he traveled. He traveled to Iraq. And he met with Abu Yusuf al-Qadi, the main student of Imam Abu Hanifa. And he met with Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani. And he loved Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani so much. So Imam al-Shafi'i said so many words of praise with regards to Muhammad bin al-Hassan al-Shaybani. And Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani, he's the one who actually, he wrote about 6 books on the usul of al-madhab of Abi Hanifa, and he preserved it. So he preserved it. Imam al-Shafi'i used to say, has a famous statement, he says, مَا رَأَيْتُ سَمِينًا فِيهِ خَيْرٍ إِلَّا مُحَمَّدْ بِنِ الْحَسَنِ I haven't seen any obese person who has good in him, who has benefit in him, except for Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani. Except, so Imam Shafi'i, by the way, Imam Shafi'i was a medical doctor as well. Imam Shafi'i was a medical doctor. Yes, but obviously did not practice so much because he was busy with al-fiqh. And he himself said, do not leave, لا تتركوا علم الطب. He said, العلم علمان. علم أديان وعلم أبدان. He said, knowledge is 2 halves. Knowledge of the deen and knowledge of the body. That means medicine. He says, لا تتركوا علم الأبدان لأهل الكتاب. فيغلبوكم عليه فتحتاجون إليهم. He said, don't leave the knowledge of medicine for the people of the book, the people of the scripture, because you might end up being in need of them. Yeah, so that was Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam al-Shafi'i, when he went to Iraq and he saw that, okay, people in Medina and Mecca, there's so much focus on hadith, but he saw people in Iraq, there's a lot of knowledge basically taken from a hadith. Some of the people who met Abu Hanifa, they said, like if he takes a hadith, one hadith, he gets so much ahkam and rulings from it. He could extract rulings from one hadith, something unbelievable. So he had this phenomenal ability to deduce, extract rulings and infer rulings from hadith. So Imam Shafi'i was impressed with his students. They have so much knowledge and understanding of the hadith that they have and they know, and they can get so much knowledge from one hadith. So he was impressed by that, so he studied with them and he learned from them. And then he built his madhab around reconciling these 2 approaches. Ahl al-Hadith wa Ahl al-Ra'i. Ahl al-Hadith and Ahl al-Ra'i. And Imam Shafi'i had a very strong tool, which is the Arabic language. He mastered the Arabic language because he grew with Banu Hudayl. With Banu Hudayl, they were the best among the Arabs who preserved the purity of the Arabic language. He grew up as a little child. His mother sent him to grow up with Banu Hudayl. So he learned. He learned the poetry of the Arabs. He was, and this is why, said one of the great scholars of the Arabic language. You know, the scholars of the Arabic language, when they want to take the meaning of a word or something about al-nahw or al-sarf, like about grammar or morphology and syntax. If they want to take it from anyone from that time, from a tabi'in or tabi'i tabi'in, they would require that person to bring what they call shahid, which is basically some poetry or some statement from the previous Arabs. Except for Imam al-Shafi'i. They said, Imam al-Shafi'i hujjatun fi al-lugha. Some of the Arab scholars, they said, kalamuhu hujjah. Kalamuhu hujjah. So anything Imam al-Shafi'i says about the Arabic language, that's evidence enough for Imam al-Shafi'i. That's evidence enough in the Arabic language. And this is why some of like his students, al-Muzani, he said, ma sami'tu al-Shafi'i yalhanu qat. Never made any mistake in the Arabic language. Any like mistake in grammar or morphology or syntax at all. At all. There's no mistake he made. And he said this was very rare. Very rare. I think it was Ibn Taymiyyah actually who said, الشافعي حجة في اللغة. If Shafi'i says something, that's it. He's an authority in language. So Imam al-Shafi'i, when he saw these two radical, seemingly dichotomous approaches, he decided to reconcile them. And he reconciled them in a very beautiful way. And this is why he came up with his book that was revolutionary. And we might actually mention it later on, his book Ar-Risala. Ar-Risala is the first book in Usul al-Fiqh. First book in Usul al-Fiqh. Basically, Usul al-Fiqh, the relationship between Usul al-Fiqh and Fiqh is exactly like the relationship between language and grammar, and language and morphology. So it's the backbone of language. It's the very structure, the codification of language. Usul al-Fiqh is the same. It shows you the back dynamics of Fiqh, what happens in the background. And this is why Imam Ahmad, he said, لَمْ نَكُنْ نَعْرِفُ الْعَامَّ وَلَا الْخَاصِ وَلَا الْمُجْمَلِ وَلَا الْمُفَصَّلِ حَتَّى جَاءَ مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ إِدْرِيسَ الشَّافِعِي. He said, we didn't know there was general statements, specific statements. We didn't know there was open statements and qualifying statements until Imam Muhammad bin Idris came. He said, the Arabs, we don't know this. We don't know this. But he managed to come up with this kind of classification. So it's the first book. And until now, you read the book, it's really fascinating. Ar-Risala is really, really fascinating. Such a fascinating book. And it's not only a book on Usul al-Fiqh, it's a book on Usul al-Fiqh, and part of it is a book on Hadith, Mustalah al-Hadith. So this is why the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh, they say the first book on Usul al-Fiqh is Ar-Risala by Shafi'i. The scholars of Hadith, Mustalah, they say the first book on Mustalah is Ar-Risala by Shafi'i. So Imam al-Shafi'i, subhanAllah, was very profound. So he had this madhab. He developed his own opinions, etc. But then later on, he traveled to Egypt. And he learned new knowledge. Because some of the students of Imam Malik actually traveled also to Egypt. So Imam al-Shafi'i built a new madhab. Like he developed in terms of fiqh and he saw some new things. So his understanding deepened and he became more mature. And in Egypt, this is why for Imam al-Shafi'i you have al-madhhab al-qadim or al-madhhab al-jadid. The old madhhab, the new madhhab by Imam al-Shafi'i. And then Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal traveled around and he collected a huge number of ahadith. And he studied with al-Shafi'i. So he was a student of al-Shafi'i. By the way, the book of Ar-Risala by Imam al-Shafi'i, and he wrote his book Al-Umm as well, like one of the most beautiful, most significant books on hadith at that time, Kitab al-Umm. Such a huge collection of fatawa from Imam al-Shafi'i. Muhammad bin Mahdi, one of the students of Imam al-Shafi'i, he says, لقد نظرت في كتاب الرسالة. I have looked into the book, I've read the book of Risala more than 100 times. And he says, every time I read it, I find new benefit. Something I never found before. So he says, كان الشافعي كالشمس للدنيا والعافية للبدن. His Imam Shafi'i was like the sun for the skies, and he was like health for our bodies. So when Imam Shafi'i passed away at a very, very young age, by the way, in his early 50s, probably about 50 or 51. Imam Shafi'i passed away when he was 50 or 51. And he died because of hemorrhoids. He died because of hemorrhoids. May Allah have mercy on him. Imam Ahmad, we said, so he studied with Imam Shafi'i. He learned from him, and he traveled to take a hadith. So he took the hadith from Medina, from Iraq, from Egypt, from Sham, from everywhere. He took the hadith, and he had such a huge collection. And he had the luxury of looking at the fiqh of all these imams. All these imams. And he was very careful about following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Even that one time he says, there's no hadith that I have come across except that I implemented it. Every hadith I saw, I implemented it. He says, even I came across the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ got someone to do hijama for him, cupping, and the Prophet ﷺ gave him dirham. So he said, straight away as I read this, I went to someone to make hijama for me, and I gave him a dirham to follow exactly what the Prophet ﷺ said. And Imam Ahmad had so many students as well. So he wrote down his fiqh and his hadith. So you'll have a lot of Masail Imam Ahmad by so many of his students. Masail, the questions that were given to Imam Ahmad. Each one of his students, a good number of them, compiled their questions to Imam Ahmad in a different collection or compilation. So generally speaking, these are the madhahab that developed at this time. There was other madhahab, obviously. There was Sufyan al-Thawri, madhahab of Sufyan al-Thawri. There was the madhahab of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the great mufassir and historian, one who's known. He had his own madhahab. Al-Layth ibn Sa'd in Egypt had his own madhab. Al-Imam al-Awza'i in Sham, he had his own madhab. So there were so many other madhab. But these are the ones that actually survived. These are the ones that survived. So this is a general description of this time. So at this time, the hadith was created, put in collections, and it became more available to people, more accessible. The fiqh itself was written, and like books of fiqh were written. So we saw from the students, for example, of Imam Shafi'i, Imam Abu Hanifa, his student Muhammad bin Hassan Shaybani wrote six big collections on the fiqh of Imam Abi Hanifa. So the fiqh started, Tadween al-Fiqh was written, collections on fiqh were written. Imam Shafi'i himself wrote Al-Risala on Usul al-Fiqh, and he wrote Al-Umm. And then his student Al-Muzani wrote a lot of his fiqh. Imam Malik, his students wrote his fatawa in what they called Al-Mudawwana. Al-Mudawwana became one of the main sources of the Maliki fiqh. These are the fatawa of Imam Malik. They were written down and documented. So these are things that happened. Imam Ahmad as well, we said, his fatawa were written by Masail Imam Ahmad, by his students. So this was an era as well of writing down the fiqh in collections and in books. It was more available, more accessible to students, more documented. And the emergence of usul al-fiqh as a science. These principles behind fiqh, now they emerged after Imam Shafi'i wrote his book. But some of the Hanafi scholars argue that they say the first one to write on usul al-fiqh was actually Ad-Dabusi, before Imam Shafi'i, one of the great Hanafi scholars. One of the great Hanafi scholars. What else about this time? So fiqh started now to revolve a lot around these four people, main four people. Obviously, the time stretched over, like, let's say, around 100 years. So it was Abu Hanifa first, then Imam Malik, then Imam Shafi'i, then Imam Ahmad. So each school started to establish itself. The students started to take the knowledge from there, from their teachers, and build their madhab and the principles, the usul of their madhab, based on their fatawa. So these are the general features of this time. These are the general features of this time. So this is what we wanted to establish today. Inshallah, next week when we meet, we'll go a little bit briefly into each madhab and the main sources, main features about this madhab. We will try to conclude with that time in order to see what happened afterwards. In order to see what happened afterwards. And we will try to pinpoint some of the differences and why they happened. Some of these differences and why they happened. So hopefully this is a good foundation, inshallah, for next week. So as I said, inshallah, after Isha, there will not be a continuation. Today was a brief kind of creating some the general or describing the general features of fiqh in that era, which is from 120 after Hijrah to around 270 after Hijrah. This is generally speaking how fiqh. So the hadith, the fiqh, and all of that took place and took shape. So it was more established now. Something very important as well to add here is actually the mustalahat al-fiqhiyya. Fiqh terminology started to develop and take shape. So wajib now was well established as, okay, that's an obligatory. Mustahab, okay, it started to take shape. So the fuqaha developed their own jargon, their own concepts, and their own terminology. They became very peculiar to the fuqaha. Had specific meanings, very well-defined meanings, and so on and so forth. So jazakumullah khairan for your attendance and for your patience. Barakallahu feekum. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.